So please join me in welcoming Dean McCann to the stage.
Thanks very much. You probably think it's pretty odd to have a financial guy in front of you, and I feel pretty odd because, you know, I'm kind of out of my league here. This is a much cooler room than I'm usually in. But I did welcome the opportunity to kind of be here. You probably think of finance guys are the guys who are saying no typically to folks like you in this room to the big projects that that all of you probably want to do in your organizations. But I think Duncan had method to his madness in asking me to do this. And really what it is the alignment around the table at Canadian Tire in terms of our officers and executives around digital strategy. And we've stopped thinking about it as digital strategy. We've started thinking about it as business strategy. So if you stop listening now, that's all I was really supposed to say, right? And because that sets up what Duncan's going to talk to you about. But look, my job is about, a big part of my job, is about ensuring that the investments we are making, and I see I got chirped earlier, about the investments we are making, that they're going to create great long-term value for our shareholders over time. I mean, that's what I'm supposed to do. Right? And let's face it, this stuff is expensive, and we're in an and world, right? So as a retailer that's been around for 90 years and has had a great history, our job is to ensure we're around for the next 90 years, right, and thrive the way we have for the last 90. And digital is going to be a fundamental part of that. And I think we recognize that around our table. It's going to be about how we communicate to our customers, interact with our customers, absolutely fundamental to our business strategy going forward. Fundamental to our brand, right, and how we think about the company, how you think about the company as customers, our employees think about the customer, the company, how our vendors think about the company, how our landlords, all of these various stakeholders, our investors think about the company. Digital is going to be a fundamental part of that. And if you cut through it, it's part of our business strategy that's going to allow this company to compete over the next 90 years and be successful. And that's what I think Duncan's going to talk to you about today. I'll tell you a quick story. I got invited by the ops guys to go out and see our new West Edmonton Mall store. It's been open about a month now, and I got invited to go out a few days before it was going to open. And it's not like they invited me out to hang out with a finance guy, right? That's not what they do. They invited me out because this thing's expensive, right? It's a lot of money to put one of these stores up. And the guys want to build more of these. We want to build more of these, right? But it's a big investment, right? And we got to get a return on that investment. So they were trying to get me hooked, right? And I got to tell you, I walked in, and this is, without a doubt, the best sports store in the world. I mean, it's a mecca for digital. Folks in this room would love it. There's 800 screens in the store. Everything that you want to do in this store is going to be digitally oriented, right? You want to buy a bike, you can test out riding that bike on a link of Tour de France. Like, it's just fantastic, right? You got to see it. And you'll see more of them over time because, as I said, I'm hooked. I see this investment and how it's going to resonate with our customers going forward, and it's going to be how Canadian Tire competes over the long term. But again, it's digital as part of a business strategy. So with that, I mean, that's really all I was supposed to do. Over to Duncan to finish the rest of the presentation, and I know you'll enjoy what he has to say to you, and thank you very much for your time.
Good morning, everyone. Dean, thanks very much for being here. I think it says a lot that we have a CFO here to help set the tone for what we're going to talk about. Dean's always telling us, don't bring me digital strategy, bring me business strategy. Don't bring me piecemeal requests for $5 million here and $10 million here and $4 million here. Show me how it all fits together, and then we'll make business decisions about how we fund things. Now, we were in a different place as a company, I think, 4 or 5 years ago. 4 or 5 years ago, we were still finishing huge legacy, long-term, multi-year builds worth tens and tens of millions of dollars. We began to get a sense near the end of some of those builds that the output was not everything that we needed it to be, or at least the business requirements 4 years earlier on some of those digital builds had changed by the time they were being delivered. But when you're, you know, 4 out of 5 years into the build, there's not a lot. It's not a lot that you can do. So we started asking why about everything we were doing in digital. You know, I've always loved the movie Moneyball, right? The guys that picked out the pitcher based on the cut of his jaw. So we're also a company that's deep into sports. And I thought I'd share a bit of a similar Moneyball moment with you. Brief clip from a high school in Little Rock, Arkansas, the football coach that started asking why about everything they did.
My name is Kevin Kelly. I'm the head football coach at Pulaski Academy. I saw a 15-minute video of a Harvard professor, and he had analyzed 2,000 football games for a 3-year period, and he had come to the conclusion that you should never punt. That's when I started asking, and I had our coaches start asking, why about everything in our program? Why are we really punting? Well, because everybody else does on fourth down.
What's up?
One of the things we don't do is we don't punt. It's numbers. It's numbers. There are so many reasons why going for it on fourth down statistically helps you win games.
Fourth and nine, fourth and nine. Let's go, Rick, right, Rick, right.
Let's say you're on your 5-yard line and it's fourth down and 7 yards to go. Okay, you gotta make it out to the 12. Well, I know this. If we go for it on fourth down right here,
fourth and four,
don't make it.
Throws. This is what Kevin Kelly believes. And the pass is incomplete. He couldn't get it.
They're going to get the ball right there, first and goal from the 5. They're going to score a touchdown 92% of the time.
You cannot run the wrong play on fourth down.
If we don't even try to go for it, and we punt it out and they get it around the 40-yard line, the number only goes from 92 to 77. It's still that hot. They're going to score anyway.
The receiver gets it on the outside, and he is in. A touchdown.
So you're basically assuring the other team points. And if you throw in our fourth down, we've got a chance to make the first down. We are right at 50% fourth down conversion rate.
Dangerous spot here.
It is fourth and a mile from their own 8-yard line.
Steps up, lobs one out there, and it is caught one more time. Zach Kelly right there, and that's enough for a first down. That's 2 fourth down catches he's made for first down.
There are those kinds of people that want to be different because they just want to be different. And there's those kinds of people that want to be different because they're looking for something to help them be more successful.
So don't punt the ball, you know? Because as it turns out, in this case, it doesn't make any sense. That takes guts, you know. It takes a lot of guts to question the status quo, to admit you don't understand something, to ask why we're doing something in the likely face of ridicule. And I think 5 years ago at Canadian Tire, we were still punting the ball a lot. I think we were making a lot of digital decisions based on what the market was doing and what everyone thought was important in digital, not because we understood why we had to make those decisions. And we were still deeply, deeply invested into legacy systems. We still had those god-awful little 1970 green screens in the automotive bays when you went there. We still used function keys to be able to change your tires, you know. When we bought FGL Sports 3 years ago with SportCheck, it accelerated our thinking on digital. Because we inherited a company like SportCheck that has this young, urban, mall-based customer, a very, very digitally savvy customer. So not only did we have to get very good, very fast at being able to work with that customer, that's the future of where the Canadian Tire customer is going. It's the future of where the Marks customer is going, which admittedly today is still an older, sometimes more rural-based customer. So our CEO and Michael Medline, who recently was appointed president of our company, put a challenge to us 3 years ago. They said, whatever you do next in digital, make sure it's world class. Defy incrementalism. Make sure it sets us up for long-term growth. So a small group got together and started asking why on everything. And we set out to define the real problems that we had, right? And the problem was not, oh God, I need an e-commerce strategy, or oh God, I need a mobile strategy, right? It wasn't one of the spam emails I get asking if I want innovative ways to collect customer data and be more relevant to my customer. We had to identify the underlying business problems that we had with digital disruption. We had to figure out how to navigate digital disruption to stay relevant to our customers. I mean, disruption is an interesting problem, right? History is littered with disruption. There's nothing new there, right? First wheel, first engine, first light bulb, first wireline communication, first wireless communication. But the digital disruption that we face today in all of our businesses is catastrophic if you don't get in front of it. And we're going to go through here a few of what I think those problems are. The first is this insane speed of innovation and speed of obsolescence. You know, there was a time not that long ago where things would last for a couple of years, right? Remember Windows 3.0? Then you went to 3.1, like you were good with that for a few years, right? 386, 486 processors were good for a few years. I had the same Motorola flip phone for about 4 years, and I love that phone, man. You couldn't break it. But today, you've got new phone releases 2 to 3 times a year. You've got apps in the App Store that make each other obsolete in a matter of weeks and not months. Everything that we're building in business, in digital, is usually obsolete by the time it hits the street, right? Usually by the time you've started scoping it, somebody else is already doing it. I think the second issue that we're facing today is incredibly rapidly evolving and changing expectations of all of us. You've got a speed of information that is unlike anything you've seen before. You know, you don't have to wait for your morning newspaper to find out what's happening in Ukraine. You can watch live video feed. You've got the credibility of social media. Even just 2 years ago, we were all happy just to have someone listen to us to do a product review. You know, our CEO, with apologies to our own brand, Yardworks, our CEO went and bought a Yardworks hose nozzle, took it home, plugged it in, the hose nozzle cracked, then the hose cracked and flooded his garage, right? So he was ticked off and he went online to give a user review on the thing. 2 years ago, we were happy just to like bark at the moon and give a user review. Today, we're seriously pissed off if there's 400 people that say the product is no good. You're asking the company why they haven't pulled it off the shelf. Your expectations have changed. Your expectation of a good user experience online is much higher today than it was a year ago. Your expectation for personalization and relevance is higher. I mean, it's insane, if you think about it, that we put out a flyer with the same product to the entire country at the same time. Not this March, but 2 Marches ago, you know, golf courses opened next weekend. But in Calgary, they were under feet of snow. Yet we happily put spring stuff in the flyer, disregarding the fact that there's entire differences in weather across the country. You expect some degree of personalization and relevance for you. Your attention span is more limited. Your desire for interactivity is higher. My kids can't understand why the TV won't swipe when they touch it, right? All they know is how to deal with an iPad, right? Your expectation for access to information is higher than it's ever been. You want affordable access. You know, you do not want, when you go to a website, a news website, to check a story, to be told that you've got 4 more free searches before they start charging you, right? It pisses you off because you just want to read the story. You want available information, okay? With apologies to half the room that's going to hate me after this, I hate pre-roll, okay? I hate pre-roll for the following reason. Used correctly or used in short snippets, it's brilliant. But when I want to watch 4 clips back to back and I have to watch the same 30-second episode 4 times in a row to watch the content I want, you're not giving me available content. You're making it harder for me as a customer to consume it. And we want information to be accessible. And I think if you look at the Netflix example of making information accessible, it's a great example. And I have a quick clip here from a speech that Kevin Spacey gave about what Netflix did to change availability of information.
Clearly, the success of the Netflix model, releasing the entire season of House of Cards at once, proved one thing. The audience wants the control. They want the freedom. If they want to binge, as they've been doing on House of Cards and lots of other shows, then we should let them binge. I mean, I can't tell you how many people have stopped me on the street and said, thanks, you suck 3 days out of my life. And through this new form of distribution, we have demonstrated that we have learned the lesson that the music industry didn't learn. Give people what they want, when they want it, in the form they want it in, at a reasonable price, and they'll more likely pay for it rather than steal it.
It's true. Let's talk about customer data, big data. Everyone knows they need big data. 90% of people don't know what the hell it actually is or what it actually means, right? data is complicated because you have to capture data. You have to store the data. And there's an incredible amount of responsibility that we know comes with storing the data. You have to analyze the data. You have to create useful insights from that analysis. Getting a 177-page report of analysis is not useful if there aren't insights coming out of it. And you have to be able to change your business processes because of the insights that came out of your data. And so many people today are so focused on just get data, get data, get data. We're not equipped exceptionally well to do anything with that data. And the worst thing that many companies do is they create a digital group to worry about it, which is as good as creating, I think, a digital ghetto. Because more often than not, the people in that digital ghetto don't have the authority inside the company to change business processes. You simply wave your arm saying, I've got some insights here. But if you're not at the executive table and you can't do things differently, if you're not going to buy differently or market differently or ship differently, change your fundamental business process, then what are you doing with that actual data? Same issue exists with content. You know, the explosion of channels requires exponential content to feed those channels. And that's not new either, right? So take radio as a new channel, right? People started with what they knew. Let's talk on the radio, so we'll do news. Okay, let's play music on the radio. We can do that. It wasn't until Orson Welles came down with War of the Worlds and convinced a country they were truly going to war with aliens that he completely shifted how people think about content in radio. The same thing has happened with the evolution of TV. Content in web pages in the early 1990s, all people did was take scans of like paper and put it up on the web page. Like that was the best they could actually do in terms of content for web, and that evolved. And now today, the necessity for content is greater than it's ever been. And you got the same flow with content. You have to capture content. You have to curate content. You have to store it somewhere. You have to segment how you use it, and then you have to distribute it. And increasingly, you have to automate how you distribute it. And I know there's lots of sessions on content, so I'm not going to go deep into campaign-based marketing turning to lifetime marketing or frequency or creative becoming content. There's lots of content things you can go to. Just the business process of getting it, making it, storing it, using it, distributing it costs millions and millions of dollars. And most people are not mapping out that entire process. There is a major fragmentation of expertise in digital today. I don't know anybody who is the digital expert, right? It was easier, frankly, 10 years ago. But right now, you know, you have experts in technology development and apps and mobile and social media and SEO and SEM and affiliates and UX and e-commerce and websites and analytics and digital media. Anyone that comes into our office that says they do it all, we throw out because it's not true. No one does all of this well. There are these incredible expertises. And the trick is finding the general contractor to figure it out for you, right? My house is a nightmare right now. Everything's breaking in my house. The pot lights don't work. The sump pump's broken. The kids busted part of the wall, right? So we have just these contractors coming in. My wife's here. She's crying right now as I'm talking about this. We have all these contractors coming in, right? And the pot light guy goes, hey, I can probably patch up your wall for you. But he's not going to do the best job, right? And the plumbing guy says that he can take a look at the lights for us because he technically can, but he's not the right guy for the job. And as businesses, we need to actually find those general contractors that can help us understand the specialists we need throughout digital. A sixth major problem, Dean talked about this, we're in an and world, not an or world. There are insanely escalating capital costs and OpEx costs required to stay current. You've got all of your legacy investments that you're still depreciating. Those are still on the books. The fact that you may have figured out today that what you did 5 years ago wasn't perfect is too bad because you still have to pay for that. And in the meantime, you have to just continue to invest new money. You have to plan for data centers. Now you have to plan for fulfillment centers. You know, marketers that can't talk about return on invested capital are going to be obsolete very, very shortly. Because what you need to be a good marketer is fundamental infrastructure and technology and digital. And digital is disrupting everything, even the investments in the stores, as Dean talked to you about with the West Edmonton Mall. You know, digital disrupts even the point of sale. You know, it's not just about a new computer system or a new scanner. If you ask why are cash registers at the front of the store? Well, before digital, it was to make sure people didn't steal stuff, right? You could gather them through. The Apple store said, we don't need you to line up at the front of the store in order to buy stuff. We'll just do a mobile checkout with you, right? Everyone puts security tags on their clothes so you don't steal them. What we discovered at the West Edmonton Mall is a security tag costs 75 cents. An RFID tag costs 12 cents. We'll double as a security tag, but we'll give you all that other product information you want when you hold the clothes up in front of a screen. So we have to figure out and plan for these escalating costs, which are not going to stop anytime soon. And I think the final major problem we see in digital today is, and you know, I'm going to ask Dean to forgive me here, but most of the C-suites of most of Canada's companies are not properly equipped to be making decisions on digital because they don't understand the implications of what's in front of them, right? You can get your head around complex stuff when you're in the C-suite. You can go to a distribution center. You don't have to be an expert in a distribution center, but you can stand there. Someone can give you an HR model. You can figure out the HR model for how many staff should work it. When they tell you that the conveyor belt is busted, you've seen the conveyor belt taking stuff from point A to point B, you know that's going to cost money. But going to the C-suite saying, quick, make a decision between Hybris or WCS, they just blink at you a lot, right? Quick, we need content management. And honestly, most C-suites don't know what you mean. And if you think about your typical... Dean goes, this is why CFOs don't attend these things, sorry. But if you think about it, who is the 60-year-old C-suite, right? Born in 1954, by the time they're 20 years old, they're in business school. You know, they've grown up with TV, they've grown up with books. You know, the biggest new thing by the time you're 23, if you're in the C-suite today, was 1977 with Star Wars, right? Movies became very, very big. By the time you're in your 30s, you're climbing the corporate ladder, right? The biggest thing in marketing is sponsorship, right? You've got Michael Jackson doing Pepsi commercials, right? But you're still a TV print sponsorship guy. You know, in your 40s, you're a VP, you know, and when you're in your mid-40s for the first time, you're using desktop computers, right? You get into your 50s, you get into the dot-com burst. By the time you're into your mid-50s, you've got the economy crashing around you. You're in charge of making decisions between 2008 and 2010 to save your company, right? And then you've got 24-year-old kids coming in asking for a couple of million dollars for social media so we can talk to each other, right? And they just look at you and say, to what business end? And you're trying to explain to them, this is how people are talking about your brand, but they don't inherently get it. Now, I think increasingly, C-suites realize they have to get it, and they're educating themselves. Dean is frankly one of the most sophisticated guys I've seen in a C-suite that gets it, and he's sitting in the CFO chair. But don't be surprised when C-suites don't inherently understand the complexity of the digital decisions in front of us. So if those are real business problems, what are real solutions? And with that much moving change in the marketplace, the easiest thing to do in business is reduce the number of moving parts, simplify and consolidate. Everyone has to start building in more open platforms. If stuff is going to be obsolete by the time you bring it to the street, if speed of innovation is going to throw new things at you, you have to have platforms. You can plug in and unplug the newest and the latest and unplug the stuff that doesn't work anymore. You got to avoid building custom legacy things just for your business that cannot be used with anything that's new. We have to centralize and consolidate how we get data and content. You got to put your data and content in the same place. Even if you yet don't know how to use it well, you have to be able to put it all in one place. You may have to segment it. We have a complex business model, right? Our Canadian Tire dealer data shouldn't be mixed with the sports experts' franchise data. Probably shouldn't be mixed with the corporate sport check data. But we need common systems, and it has to be in the same place. And in terms of content, we're ripping our marketing teams apart around content right now. We're doing reorgs just to put content at the center of everything we do. We're taking it so seriously at Sport Check, we're building a wall in the cafeteria in Calgary at Sport Check. You know, a wall that's about as big as this entire thing behind me here. And we're putting about 25 screens up on the wall. And the center of the wall is going to be the primary content screens. And then there's a secondary number of screens, and then your tertiary screens. And for every single thing we do, we're forcing the marketing teams to put your content on the wall. So if it's going to be TV first, put TV in the middle, and then put social around, and then put print at the outside. If print is the primary content, put it in the center and then build it out. And when you stare and you look at the wall and you see the same flyer image on 12 of your 20 screens, you're probably not curating enough content to feed your channels. And we're building it in the cafeteria to change the culture of the place. We're going to force every single person in Sport Check to walk into the cafeteria every day and look at the content wall and understand that marketing is more than TV and marketing is more than flyer. And even in social media, you need different content to feed your different channels. And availability and quality of content is going to make you win. You know, Betamax was arguably a better platform than VHS, but there was more content for VHS and it won. You know, we did the ice truck ad. I don't know how many of you saw that. 2 million views of ice truck online. It ended up on the front page of the CNN website. It was in the New York Times. It was just good content. In order to deal with this fragmentation of expertise that we talked about, you have to insource digital experience. You should never, ever outsource a strategic differentiator. So we started stealing the best people in the industry. We brought in Eugene Roman from OpenText as our chief technology officer. You know, we brought in people that opened up Communitech for us down in Kitchener-Waterloo, so we're innovating right beside Google. You know, we brought in the best talent to open our new Winnipeg Cloud Computing Center that drives private cloud off V-block computers, you know, the same computing power that Facebook uses. We hired the best from Bell. We hired the best from BlackBerry. We continue to hire the best in the industry to in-house our expertise. And even more important than that is we're building digital intelligence into every business unit. So the Sport Check store up on Yonge Street, don't know how many people have been to that. That was our first shot a year and a half ago at digitizing retail. And initially, marketing kind of ran that project, and it wasn't going well. It only took hold when the store operations team embraced digital and learned digital. And it was amazing to watch how the store ops team built the Sport Check digital lab just north of Eglinton on Yonge Street. And in there, we have, I think, 180 screens. I think we're running 80 custom channels of content. By the way, the ACC has 1,100 screens. They only run 12 channels of content, okay? We're running 80 custom channels of content up at the Yonge Street store so that when you're in front of the Nike women's running table, you're looking at Nike women's running content on the screen. But we didn't have an IT roadmap. There was no 50% contingency. It just offends me for anything in business when someone says, here's how much it costs, and we could overrun by 50%, right? It's just, that's unacceptable going forward from a business point of view. So the store ops guys said, okay, let's just work this backwards. We need screens. Who sells screens? Couple companies here, let's pick one. Samsung, you're the screens. Now we need stuff for the screens. So where are we gonna get the stuff? We're gonna call vendors, and they're gonna send us, you know, content, and we're gonna curate our own content. Great, who's gonna do that? We got no one to do that. Okay, let's launch an actual production team in Calgary. What do they need to do that? They need a production studio. We built a production studio in Calgary with dozens of screens on the wall with a team that could curate content. Okay, now we gotta push that content to the screens. Who does that? We called up Eugene Roman and said, who do you think? We picked Stratacache. It was this very kind of operational, almost militaristic view of building that store. There was no IT roadmap involved. And you know what? There's a lot of stuff we busted along the way, but it was a very, very pragmatic way of using our in-house expertise and building an expertise in a store ops group to bring digital to life. You have to fuel a culture that embraces digital. And you have to do things yourself to drive cost effectiveness. When we built that Yonge Street store, we outsourced a community screen that we had there. It was this interactive screen. We spent give or take about $1 million outsourcing it. By the time we built the West Edmonton Mall store for SportCheck a year and a half later, our own team built all of our on-screen technology. A very similar application that we spent $1 million on a year and a half ago, we spent $12,000 on for the West Edmonton Mall store because we built it ourselves. We developed the in-house expertise. So what's going to differentiate companies that prepare for digital well? We would argue four things. Get your data right, get your content right, be able to build your own technology cheaply and reuse it, and get your underlying infrastructure on open platforms. So no matter whatever else happens, whatever else comes at you, you've got the fundamentals to succeed. That being said, if you don't get your people behind you, and you don't get your culture behind you, if you don't have a top-down vision from the C-suite and your executives and your CEO and your CFO that says this is important, it's going to get relegated to a digital ghetto. If you don't build the talent inside of your team to embrace digital, if store operations doesn't embrace digital, and it's always up to the marketing department or the digital department to do it, it will never take hold. If you don't have a test and learn culture that's not punitive when you make mistakes, but embraces mistakes because you've learned how to do something better, you'll never get from $1 million build to a $12,000 build because you have to make mistakes to get there. So I think we're all still learning on this journey. And there's a lot of impressive and unsustainable digital flash that we see out there right now. And honestly, we're as guilty as anybody in pulling some of that off. You know, the Yonge Street store is absolutely brilliant, right? Wall Street Journal called it the most digital retail environment in North America. We must have made 100 mistakes along the way. You know, we still barely have the content strategy we need behind the scenes to fuel that store. We still have people panicking to put, you know, new digital up on the screen, new content up on the screen. You know, in that store, we have a digital escalator wall. It's brilliant, right? So Xbox Kinect technology sees you coming. It triggers an on-screen visual experience. So as you go up the elevator, first time we built it, it was like a ski hill, right? These people like came up the ski hill with you. So then we said to one of our agencies, okay, we need a summer version of that now. So let's have a woman running a hill beside you while you go up the escalator. So we did the marketing brief. The agency went out and shot it. They came back, we loaded it up. The first time we tried it, we were shocked. Because what happened was the director on site shooting the content had never had to shoot for 24 vertically climbing, moving screens before. Right? He's used to thinking about one screen. So when he got out there and the brief was shoot side by side a woman running a hill, he said, no, I think it would look better if we pull the camera back and create an interesting angle. And by the time we ran it on the screen, it looked like you were stalking and chasing this woman and she was running for her life to get away from you going up the screen, right? And we blew a $75,000 investment and had to redo it. But we actually had to go back and take our marketing agencies and like show them what we were doing and say, I know you've never had to shoot content like this before, but understand what it is. You know, Canadian Tire launched the digital catalog. This is truly some of the most brilliant architecture I've ever seen. I actually argue this should be the future of the Canadian Tire webpage. It is part catalog, part product information, it's ordering, it's fully integrated social feeds, it's magazine and editorial content. It's embedded stories and from inside of videos. When you see the Cake Boss doing a video, you can click in the video. If you click an item in the video, it'll pull the product information up. You can find social interaction on the product information. You can buy the rolling pin. It's truly brilliant. We do not have a sufficient content management system behind that to keep it fresh. So we launched it. It was awesome, and now it's sitting there, and the team is panicking about how to keep it fresh. We didn't have the sustainable foundation. You know, 4 years ago, we said, okay, we have to get an e-commerce solution out there. Canadian Tire got out of e-commerce a number of years ago. It just wasn't doing it well. We hadn't bought FGL yet. We had Mark's. And there was a compelling case to be made going, God, 4 years ago, we can sell clothes online. Trust us. We need a few million dollars. We'll do a throwaway solution until we get an enterprise-wide platform. Let's build an e-commerce platform. So it was built. And today, we're looking at millions of dollars to completely redo it because the business criteria we put around it a couple of years ago, because we didn't have our foundation down. Honestly, we didn't even have that digital expertise through the company. The IT guys went to the business guys and said, how do you want me to build it? Okay, the very second that your IT guys and your business guys are not on the same page, you're dead, right? So the business guys went, well, I don't know. And the IT guys said, well, how many people a day do you think are going to shop? And business guys that know nothing about e-commerce said, I don't know, I can't imagine more than a couple hundred people a day. So they built the site for 200 people a day to buy stuff. And before Christmas, we had 3,500 people a day buying stuff. And the site is just cracking at the seams. It was built in a way where if you want to put something on sale, it's actually quite easy. You open up a screen, you click a product, and you click sale. The downside, as we found out before Christmas, is if you forget to hit the product and you just hit the sale, we put every goddamn thing in Marks on BOGO before Christmas for one day. Because someone hit the BOGO button without hitting a product button, right? So there's fun, you know. So I would argue we don't have a sustainable e-commerce solution, but we're going to. And Canadian Tire has just launched something. At SportCheck, we are building what I believe will be the most sophisticated commerce solution, you know, in retail in the world, with the first phase launching later this year and a major phase launching next year. And the next get in behind that is Marks. So that being said, as a company, we have done some things a lot better through our test and learn culture. This is the West Edmonton Mall store that Dean talked to you about. 800 screens in the store, which include, you know, a lot of tablets that our staff are using, 470 screens embedded in the wall, 240 custom channels of content being produced in our production facility in Calgary. We're a retailer, but we're now in the business of producing content. All these screens are near-field communication enabled, RFID enabled. They're all touch. They're interactive. We have translucent display boxes. So we have teams that have to figure out how do you take content and make it live on a translucent display box. That's very different than just taking a picture from the flyer and slapping it online. We have tablets for the staff that are loaded with content. So at the point of sale, when you hold that shoe in your hand, staff can say, have you seen the ad related to that shoe? Pull it up on their tablet. Throw it up to one of the screens in store. The experience that Dean talked about, whether it's bicycle fitting or a digital putting lab or, you know, custom insoles for your gait analysis, custom insoles for your snowboard shoes, rock climbing, it's a fantastic store. It also, I think, points at what retail is going to look like in 10 years from now. You know, everyone is scared of showrooming. I think the term is a bit overused. Think about what people want out of a retail environment, okay? I don't think you really, in the middle of a snowstorm, want to go to Canadian Tire to buy salt. Optimally, you'd love someone to drop that at your door, right? You know, optimally, if you're putting together something for your kids, you know, and you don't have the right screwdriver, do you really want to get in the car and go down to Canadian Tire, or do you want someone to drop the screwdriver off at your house? I can order a pizza in 30 minutes. But I can't get someone to bring a screwdriver to my house when I need it. But there are reasons why you want to go to a retail store, right? I think in the spring to buy a new barbecue, you want to go and walk a long line of shiny barbecues. If you're going to buy a tent, you want to feel how big the tent is, right? There's a lot of reasons to go to retail, but retail is going to be about the experience you provide in store. And increasingly, I think a lot of those day-to-day jobs, the light bulbs, the screws, you know, those are things that optimally you would love to have delivered to you. So our vision as a company is be a world leader in digitizing retail, not be a world leader in digital. We're not a digital company. We are a retail company. And the fundamentals of retail stay the same even in the world of digital disruption. We have customers. We have to source and buy products for them. We have to ship those products in. We have to market those products to the customer. We have to convince the customer to come and buy them. We have to close the sale and send the customer out with the product. That all is still very much true. But think about how you buy products. Again, as I said, the idea of national assortments are insane. The first thing our Canadian Tire dealers would say to us is get me products that are seasonally relevant to my community when I need them and how I need them. So why do retailers in particular buy national assortments and market them nationally? In part, it's because we're not collecting data. We don't know our customers well enough. We're not changing our business processes based on that data. In part because all we've ever known is running a business off of flyer productivity, right? We literally have hundreds of people that do flyer productivity. So we will know in a single box, in a flyer, you know, exactly how much money we're going to make off that box, you know, next, you know, week 11 of next spring. We know if we put a certain kind of product at a certain kind of price point, we can almost guarantee the number of units that we can sell with a 4 or 5% comp built in, because we've been doing it for 90 years. The analytics around flyer would blow your mind how good they are, right? But you have to then think about what happens when your customer doesn't read the flyer anymore. Now, the Canadian Tire flyer is not going anywhere anytime soon. It's the most read piece of paper in the country. There's 11 million flyers every Saturday that go out the door. One day, we will sit back and say it was just insane that anyone pushed 11 million pieces of paper out the door every Saturday, right? But our ability to test and learn is not a Canadian Tire, where we do still have a slightly older demographic that does still love that flyer, and it drives sales, hands down. If you pull a flyer in a single week, your sales drop. Sport Check is different. Sport Check, less than a third of our customers at Sport Check still read the flyer. It's even, I think, since we did those stats a year and a half ago, it's gone less than that. I think it's down to almost 17%. So we still invest upwards of $20 million a year at SportCheck, putting flyers out the door, because it's all we've ever known. So we started a project about a year and a half ago, particularly with Facebook, to say, how do we completely change the model and digitize the flyer? That does not mean PDF the flyer and put it online so you can, like, digitally turn the page, right? It's how do you take those products and more relevantly put them in front of consumers. So we said to the merchants, guys, we're working on killing the flyer. And they either laughed at us or scowled at us, but they didn't believe that it was going to happen, right? So you had to do a lot of testing to convince the system that you can still make money out of digitizing the flyer. So we did 18 weeks of testing. We isolated products, we isolated markets. We looked at what, you know, if we put money into digital, what's the net lift in profit off of that? And we showed, hands down, that we can better than comp the flyer with digital investment, right? We even 1 week, just to prove it, all of footwear was down about 2%. We took one shoe, did a $20,000 blast just in the GTA, and in-store sales on that one shoe went up 12% that week. And then we turned it off, and the sales in that shoe dropped back down to -2 along with everything else. The other thing we found is we actually put our paper flyer to the same rigor of testing that we were doing in our digital. We had never really looked at the profitability of the flyer and discovered at SportCheck, one out of every two flyers that we were putting out the door, that we are putting out the door, actually have a negative ROI on them. We spend more money pushing the paper out the door than we do in the net lift and profit on those products that are coming in the door. So this year, for the first time, twice before June, at SportCheck, we're pulling the paper flyer totally out of the market and replacing it entirely with digital spend. And when that works as well as I think it's going to work, we're going to escalate that into the back half of the year. And if we can make this work the way I hope and think it will, I believe within a couple of years, we will no longer have a paper flyer at SportCheck. It will be fully digitized. Now, that's fun for marketers. Let's talk about the business chaos that comes with that just for 1 second, right? So week 11, you know, spring starts, you know, the front page of the SportCheck flyer, six little boxes of stuff, the top right is a bicycle. We know if we put a $600 to $800 bicycle in that box, that we'll probably do about 4,000 units of sales in the 2 weeks that follow. And that's based on about a 4% increase off of last year's stuff, and they've been doing that for 30 years. So now, don't put out that flyer. Instead, only market that bike to people that want to see bikes online. Work with Google, work with Facebook, work with affiliates, you know, work through a number of different channels and target out that bike. So the merchants when we tell them this, they look at us and they blink a lot. And they go, well, how many bikes am I going to sell? Yeah, I don't know, right? Arguably a lot more, because we're only showing the message that's relevant to the audience. So here's what's going to happen. We're going to sell 6,000 bikes instead of 4,000 bikes, which means we're going to be out of stock, because we bought those bikes, you know, 9 months ago in China, and they're on a ship somewhere, and they're coming in, so that's done, right? So then customer sat scores are going to drop, because you're going to come in looking for the bike. It's going to be out of stock. And all the employees that get bonuses based on customer sat are going to get marked down. So then next year, the merchants are going to go, I'm going to buy 6,000 bikes plus 4%. But guess what's going to happen now? They're going to show up at the distribution center. And for 30 years, the distribution center has had a plan for storing those bikes. Now you got to store this many bikes. So it screws up all your slots at your distribution center. And then you got to get trucks to take the bikes to the store where customers are probably going to pick them up. And we have cost per cube nailed in our supply chain, right? So now you got to put more trucks on the road because bikes are a big cube item. And then the bikes get to the store and stores have planograms, right? And now you got to store this many bikes. So your soccer section gets whacked out by all these new bikes, right? So you've got entire value chain chaos because we marketed one bike digitally this spring. And we're going to do that to 72 products twice before June, and we're going to be heading to doing that with the entire business. It's going to take us a couple of years to establish those new baselines off of digital instead of print. And that's scary. That's scary to do. But that's what digital disruption is. So as Dean always says, don't ask me what my digital strategy is. Ask me what my supply chain strategy is. We truly have one of the most sophisticated supply chains in the world. The amount of stuff we move is unbelievable. The American military has actually toured our facilities because we move everything that the US Army needs to go to war, right? We move guns, we move ammunition, we move boats, we move ATVs, we move tents, we move clothes, we move water, we move chemicals, right? It's easy for us after 90 years to put propane and chemicals, wheelbarrows, tools, a bunch of small screws, and a Christmas tree in a truck and ship it to a store. No problem. I can't send a pair of shoes to your house in 4 hours. That will crash the entire system, right? So the question is not what's the digital strategy. What is your supply chain strategy to deal with the disruption of digital? And you can do that for everything in your business. The corporate groups are not immune, right? We want to use content from our big vendor partners in the West Edmonton Mall store. The legal groups that did the contracts for the star athletes that shot the content in the US forgot that content would have to cross borders. So they didn't have an international IP digital rights clause in the contract, so we can't use certain Nike and Adidas and Under Armour content in our stores because the legal team didn't put it in there. You know, your HR teams are responsible for your intranets. Say that word out loud, right? Intranet. You spend your entire life in social media, you know, multi-way communication, then you go to work and you got to get a one-way download of information being pumped out by the office, right? So digital disruption is swamping everyone, and no one is immune. And I won't take you through today, you know, the impact on the in-store experience, how you have to change product knowledge, how you have to do drive-to-store online. I didn't even talk about e-commerce, really, today, where we have to be exceptionally good. But without a great data strategy and a great content strategy and a great underlying infrastructure, building an e-commerce system is, well, you will successfully sell some stuff, but you'll never be able to scale it. Online user experience, POS, endless aisle. So the bottom line for us is, and we've said it 10 times now, our digital strategy is a retail strategy. It's a business strategy underpinned by a culture and a team that are prepared to invest and believe in digital. And we're rushing to build the digital foundation necessary to be a world leader in digitizing retail, and we're happy to share our experiences and mistakes along the way with all of you. So thanks very much for your time today. That's great.